with this global problem? Thank you, Prof. Lin.
I think that obviously there are cultural differences and people are always different. But I think something like this pandemic, it is problematic. It is a terrible thing that has happened. We already suffered the bad consequences. And because it is so terrible, we all know we must change. If it were less terrible, we may not want to change. So we all know we have to change, and we all know we must change, irrespective of whatever culture we come from. We have to face reality, and the reality says we have to change. And because of this, people can be united by a common vision to change. And if they can be united for a common vision and say, this is what we want in our life, they will all work towards this. I think this is important for communities, for governments, even for universities, to put forward this perspective and say, this is our opportunity to achieve something good for ourselves, which we could not do in the past because we can't unite our people to do so. And now we can. And we must never and should never miss such an opportunity. And we have the technology today that are available already. So what the pandemic could cause is, instead of waiting 10 years or longer to try to implement these technologies, we can say, let's implement it. And the people will agree simply because there is no better option.
Thank you, Professor. Thank you, Pak Mangadat. Is that satisfying, or you would like to follow up?
Great. Thank you so much. Thank you, Prof. Lee.
Thank you. Professor, we have a question from Prince Songkla University. The person with the ID XPS, would you like to express it yourself, or would you like me to read it? So you can turn on your microphone. No? Yes, you are on now.
Good morning. Like, good morning, I'm Farouk.
Professor.
Yeah, Prof. Chong, recently during the COVID, we found that in Malaysia, I saw there are news about a girl in the rural area who is studying in the university has got to climb a tree to get the connection of internet. So most countries in Southeast Asia, they are lacked of this technology of internet connectivity. So what will happen to those countries, to those area who cannot adjust to this internet connectivity? What is your opinion? Will they be left out? Thank you very much, Prof. Chong.
Yes. Obviously, countries without internet connection, without able to connect new technology, would have grave difficulty. It's as a normal society. COVID-19 won't change that. Even rich countries that fail to move on in a new technology, but rather they want to keep on fighting among themselves or with others, they also will have difficulty. Because people have to make a concerted action to change. And I would say for today, most places, even you look at our poorer regions in our ASEAN region, the internet is there. You may have to climb a tree, but you can still connect. And that is the reality. You see, what the example you brought forth is an excellent example of the human spirit to fight and therefore to change things. And this is what we need to tap in this very difficult situation, to get unity, to act together as communities, as nations, to overcome this grave problem. If we are able to do that, and apply the new technologies to our advantage, we will have a much better situation at the end of the day, despite the pandemic. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor. Any other questions from the floor? No? Somebody? Okay, there is a question from Mr. Mangari Situmorang. Would you like to say a question? Mr. Mangaris, your microphone is on.
Hello, good morning, everyone.
Hello.
There. Professor yes. Lee, I'm a teacher and an educator here in Surabaya. I would like to ask you, in this pandemic nowadays, what is the best performance for educators in this year ahead? Thank you very much.
Sorry, can you repeat your question because we can't hear you too well. Can you please repeat your question?
Okay. I am a teacher here in Surabaya.
No, just repeat your question. Yeah.
That's why I ask, what is the best performance for educators meanwhile the pandemic eras nowadays? Thank you.
To make the effort, you make?
Professor, I'll help. It's the question from Mr. Mangaris is, how is the best performance for teachers or educators in particular in junior schools? So probably, what do you think is the best, what is required from teachers and educators?
In junior schools?
Yes.
Well, this is not my area of expertise because but having children, of course, I know the young children love the new technologies involving internet because they love to play internet games. Now, most of us who take the attitude and say this is bad, they are wasting too much time. But I think we need to spend time understanding the children and say, okay, why are they playing? Can we interest them to learn, for example, to make games? Make simple computer games instead of just playing computer games. Can we interest them to do something helpful, needful? Now, I am not a technologist, and I would not have the capability of doing such things. But I think there are many things we can do. For example, if you look at the internet and what is available, virtual reality, we can use that to take students out on virtual tours to faraway places to see what life and society could be. Now, this is, for example, possible today with the new technology. And so a child who is interested in the internet because of the game could now learn much more about the internet, the use of the internet, and what it could do for them in terms of knowledge acquisition, in terms of interacting with the teacher at times when they are not in school. Now, all these have now become possible, things which in the past are impossible. And whatever the grade the child is in, all these technologies are available for us to use. But of course, we all need to learn. And I think that is the issue here, and that is the challenge before all of us. The internet offers us immense opportunities to learn. Of course, it is also immense opportunity to waste our time. Connecting is one of the best things that can happen to us as human beings. But connecting can also take away all our time that we have no time for anything else, which would be tragic. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor. We have a raise of hands from Dr. Ramon Ricardo Roque.
Good morning, Emeritus Professor Dr. Lee Choi Chong. I am I am Cardi Roque from San Beda University. Aside from the current workplace health and safety protocols, what are some of the best practices that other ASEAN countries who have successfully mitigated the effects of the pandemic implement in their own countries? As you would always say, learn to learn quickly.
Yes, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
This is exactly the type of skill we need to make sure our students have. To learn quickly. Because the pandemic is something totally new to all of us. Our experts also do not have the full knowledge of this virus and the problems they cause and how they are caused. And in the midst of the pandemic, they are finding this out very, very quickly. I'm grateful to them for their great effort. So that today we have at least quite some understanding of what is happening. But this understanding, of course, also means that we have to prepare for the worst. You know, we say talk about the best practices. I wouldn't want to talk about best practice anymore because just look at my own country, Singapore. We started off extremely well, right? But then suddenly, one slip, we let people in, our workers from the region, all right, thinking that they are fine because, yeah, they should be fine based on the statistics that were declared, but obviously they are not. And then, of course, we have crowded living spaces that they live in, which somehow were overlooked. And so you see, these are all little issues. And you say, oh, this is the same everywhere, right? Because, you know, they don't have money. Of course, they live in places that are not so, they are more crowded and so on. We same with everywhere in the world, in all regions like that. But the whole point is this. We overlook, all right? Of course, we can say, terrible, how can we have this oversight? But we can also look at it and say, well, it is normal to overlook things. Right? When we are all human and we do make some mistakes. And this is where, of course, yeah, the type of problem we are facing today with this pandemic. Yes, there are good practices and everybody seems to be taking up these good practices. But of course, however careful we are, we can make little slips here and there. And of course, we create new clusters of infection again. So this is the problem, all right? So essentially then the best practice is to learn and to learn quickly, as you have said correctly. And of course, to learn to be careful and careful all the time. Thank you.
Yes, ladies and gentlemen, we still have time for one more question, if there is any. If there isn't any from the floor, I would like to take this opportunity to conclude. Oh, there is one from Berlian Afriansyah. Mr. Berlian Afriansyah. Your microphone is on. You can unmute yourself, Mr. Berlian Afriansyah. No, unfortunately, we cannot connect with Mr. Berlian Afriansyah. You can write your question on the chat. Probably Professor Chong can respond to you later. Yeah, I'll take this opportunity to conclude, if I may, Professor. So yes. I really like your first statement. Change is necessary to survive. So change is not something that we require to be better than the others now. It's for us to survive. It's essential now. And I also like the way you say that we need transformation. Transformation means a change, but a change to be in a better position, not just any change. And also we need to involve everyone in this. And I can sense that you have put emphasis on enabling, empowering the students at this time of difficulties. We should focus more on the students. And the last point that I would like to highlight is how you should see technology. Should we see it as an opportunity or a threat? It really depends on us. With that note, I would like to end this keynote session. And I would like to ask you to join me in applauding for Professor. Thank you very much for your inspiring speech. And ladies and gentlemen, we will resume with the webinar, the first session of the webinar shortly. But first, to give us time to prepare, please enjoy a song from Unpar's choir. It's a traditional song singing about traditional bird from Sunda, Manuk Dadali.
Thank you.
Enjoy. Choir. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the first session of ALN International Webinar with the theme, The Future of Higher Education. The current condition we are facing is undebatedly challenging for all. None of the countries or the societies in the world is prepared for the magnitude of the pandemic and its impacts. Many are still figuring how to deal with the current issues, particularly on health and basic needs, while others have started figuring out what the future will look like and how to ensure their existence in the much likely challenging future. It is the same for higher education. While human beings will never stop striving for knowledge and skills, the question is, will the way to acquire these needs remain the same? And how should higher education service providers adjust to the modified needs and demands? To discuss this, we have three speakers from Indonesia, Malaysia, and the Philippines. Our first speaker is Mangadar Situmorang, PhD, currently in his second term as Director of Parahyangan Catholic University. Mr. Mangadar's BA and MA in International Relations is from Gajah Mada University, or UGM, and his PhD is from Curtin University, Perth, Western Australia. Mr. Mangadar's expertise is on humanitarian intervention, conflict and peace studies, and Indonesian politics. But today, he's not going to talk about conflict resolution, Pak Mangadar. Am I right? Mr. Mangadar's presentation will be on Indonesia's higher education in post-COVID-19, a need for deregulation and restructuring. Pak Mangadar, the camera is yours.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Sylvia. Thank you to the time already provided for me. And again, I would like to extend my gratitude to Professor Lee Choi for the insightful and not only provoking us in making transformation or changes within our own higher education, but also I would like to say positively to encourage all of us, yeah, to make again the best adjustment, yeah, to deal with the pandemic and also, of course, in the post-COVID-19. So again, Professor Lee Choi, thank you very much for the inspiring thoughts. And I would be also great and thankful to the ideas and experience also shared by Father Aloy and also Professor Jainai, yeah, respectively from Manila and Malaysia. So this is the forum for us again to share each other about our deep concern and hopefully again to encourage all of us, yeah, to give support for each other to deal and successfully again to overcome the pandemic problem. Honorable participants, the things that I'm going to share with you, to some extent, is this more Indonesian perspective or Indonesian expertise practices, but also I'd like to say also to some extent it is also related to the experience or the way UNPAR, my own university, Parahyangan Catholic University, try to deal with these issues or this problem. So again, this is more a bit Indonesian sense or Indonesian point of view, yeah, to share with all participants here. In general, please, could you please show my PowerPoint? Yeah, in general, the outline that I'm going to share with you is just a kind of, let's say, making some sort of, let's say, forecasting and backcasting of our missionary objective, ultimate goal as higher education institution. Yeah, this is very universal that all universities, higher education institution, use to state, yeah, the objective, yeah, the ultimate goal, as I said in my own word, missionary goal, yeah, missionary objective of our university. Yeah, as Professor Lee say, to enable, to empower young people, young generation, yeah, to be independent, mature, yeah, critical, but also then to be more contributive, to be a personal betterment, yeah, part of the civilization process, yeah, contributive to the society, for the bonum commune, the very common terms in our Christian and Catholic institution, yeah, the goodness of the people. But I'm going to this question, yeah, are we higher education institution are really moving there, moving towards such kind of objective? This is always an inspiring idea. We foresee, we forecast our future. And then we raise also the second question as part of the monitoring and evaluation process, backcasting, we call it. Yeah, are we there already? Yeah, so if, let's say, yes, we have already there, to what extent that we have been achieved, yeah, reach such kind of goals. But if not, why? You make some sort of, again, part of our internal system process of evaluation process. Yeah, we call it again continuing improvement. Yeah, and more specifically in the context of the pandemic, yeah, what should we do? Yeah, how do we perceive the pandemic? Yeah, our perception about this one is a good starting point for us to move ahead. Yeah, so there's also some kind of my concern in this sharing session. So in general, yeah, if you take a look back our missionary goals, objective, that could be seen as universal one. Yeah, we used to refer to some sort of, let's say, institution or culture or any other things to say about the objective, the goals of running higher education. We used to say again to improve, yeah, the ability, the competence in terms of cognition, cognitive aspect, the affection, and also the skill, the psychomotorics, the ability of our student. And we used also to refer to the UNESCO point of view about the objective, to empower our student to know, to do, and the most challenging one is to ask our student to support them with ability to live together in differences, yeah, in a big challenges, but also for them to be someone who are meaningful, impactful to the civilization. And also we used to refer to the World Economic Forum, yeah, that could be classified to the hard skills, which is include the point of, let's say, knowing and doing. But we already very frequently heard about this one, that hard skills could be expired, could be obsolete, could be irrelevant. So what is the most important things is about soft skills, yeah? Communication skills, critical thinking, yeah, complex problem solvings, and so on. So that's the one that we are dealing with also about our objective. And I'm going to share also about our institution, and especially in Indonesia, through the higher education institution. Yeah, again, our higher education institution, yeah, got the task, the obligation or the responsibilities, yeah, to enable our student to be again an independent person, yeah, a mature individuals, competence, yeah, and also another point is competitive, yeah, have the power, the ability, the competence to compete with others, yeah, and the last point is about contribution to the society is already very clear, underlined by Professor Lee Choi. So, but the problem is, yeah, if you come to the reality, how we manage, how we run our higher education institution, we used to come with the next problem, yeah, which is more managerial things. We are very busy, get hectic, yeah, to manage the input aspect of the higher education institution, to make sure that the process is in line with the things already stated or made by others, including by the state institution. We are working hard with the output about the graduates, yeah, about the alumni, about the publication,
And also, yeah, we work very hard about getting accreditation, getting ranking, recognition, and reputation. Yeah. Later on, we talk about the outcome. Yeah, that universities or academic institutions should be the agent of innovation through that kind of, let's say, incubator and so on. So this is the reality, yeah, and this is the big challenge for us, yeah, in running. Again, I'm sharing from my own position in chairing or leading these universities for a couple of years already. Yeah, we work hard about the input, the process, output, and outcome. The next one, yeah, we see that again, in reality, in a very general one, sometimes we realize that our objective, ultimate goals already distorted or distracted by some sort of, let's say, commercial orientation. Yeah, that the university higher education tends to be more expensive, tends to be exclusive, and some people also claim to be more elitist. Yeah, and also again, distracted by administrative load. Yeah, and the next point is about again our connection to the workplace, to the job market. Yeah, higher education institution used to be blamed for mismatch about the graduates and the need for workplace or work markets. So this is the one again, the reality we are dealing with, apart from the recent pandemic. Yeah, this is a some sort of, let's say, continuing pressure. Yeah, we here in universities or academic institution. And in Indonesia, another point of view for sharing again. Yeah, the next slide, please. Yeah, in Indonesia, we have about 4,700 higher education institution, a huge number, yeah, with some sort of problems related to the relationship state university or public university against the private one. 70% or almost 80% of higher education in Indonesia are private institution run by the society, yeah. And also to some extent, it is also influenced or impacted by some sort of religious values compared to the academic and scientific point of view. Another issue is we are also not clear enough up to these days, the differences between academic orientation of the universities, the academic characteristic of our higher education, and the vocational characteristic. We have universities, we have also polytechnics, and within university, we have some kind of, let's say, vocational activities. And another one very much related, I would like also to highlight the point of, let's say, higher education institutions in Indonesia are overwhelmingly influenced by the idea of, let's say, global, international standard and standardization. Yeah, that to some extent distract also our universities in Indonesia from our local characteristic, localities, local wisdom, and so on. Because we are very much work on the kind of, let's say, global standard. This is the problem we are faced also in Indonesia. The next one, yeah, I'm going again to share with the ideas of, let's say, situation of the pandemic. Yeah. Thanks to pandemic, yeah, if I can say thank you by saying that the pandemic is a big changer. Yeah, it's an accelerator toward digital education or digitalized education. Yeah, from my own experience in Parahyangan Catholic Universities, before the pandemic, we have asked our academic societies to implement the online learning. But after a couple of years, the number is just about 30% of the student and also the academic staff use the online learning. But after pandemic, no other choice. Yeah, 100% should be run online. So this is a kind of, let's say, blessing in disguise, yeah, with the pandemic. Yeah, no more alternative. Yeah, online learning is not a choice. Yeah, it is a must. And also in other activities in administering or running the university, yeah, we try to do it from home. Yeah, no longer in office. Yeah, and these kind of things, I would like to also to share the idea that the post-pandemic seems to make the higher education businesses or affairs more populist one, hopefully, but still questionable, yeah, and still need more further discussion about this, yeah. But I'm going to say again, to some extent, higher education in Indonesia has been part of the global standard, and to some extent, make our university academics, yeah, lose the food, yeah, no longer rooted on local culture and so on. So after this one, the idea is that higher education in Indonesia need deregulation. Yeah, that's the next point. Yeah, that's the my main argument or ideas to share with you. But I have to acknowledge, to make it clear, that before the pandemic, which hit Indonesia from February to March, our Minister of Education, a very young person, very young guy, I saw he is about 30s years old. Yeah, our Minister of Education has proposed the idea, we call it in Indonesia, Merdeka Belajar and Kampus Merdeka. Yeah, which freely interpreted as, let's say, studying independently and autonomous campus. This is my personal interpretation about the idea. So the minister, the higher education institution, initiate this kind of, let's say, a new way in running higher education in institution by introducing the idea of independent studying and autonomous campuses. Yeah, this is the idea. So in this point, I would like to say, in very general one, these policies taken by the minister, yeah, the former executive director of Gojek in Indonesia. Yeah, he introduced this policy again, which could encourage, yeah, support flexibility, and to some extent, I would like also localities, providing more support to the higher education, including the idea of facilitating the higher education. Collaborate with industry, that's the next point. Very strongly emphasize about this idea. And also a very challenging one for our conventional way in running universities is giving the opportunity for our students to take 2 or 3 semesters outside of our own institution. Yeah, this is a very radical one, very fundamental one, where students are allowed or offered, yeah, to take 2 or 3 semesters outside his or her own study program and institution. So this is the idea of the Campus Merdeka. yeah, and has been in the place again about such kind of deregulation. The things needed is restructuring. That's also my idea, yeah, that I'm offering, yeah.
In general, 3 minutes.
Yes, thank you. Yeah, in general, we have to realize, to acknowledge that we are too academic orientation, too knowledge-based, yeah, knowledge-based institution, too global orientation, international orientation, times high education ranking, yeah, QS ranking, and so on. Too many institutions in Indonesia. So the point later is we need to be more focusing on, let's say, vocational institution. And also another point is about the need for autonomy, yeah, for higher education institution. This is the one as part of the regulation process that, again, before it is a kind of, let's say, over-regulation. Yeah, higher education is over-regulated. So the regulation is another point, yeah, and restructuring. We will come to the last point, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah, as my closing notes, yeah. The first one again, that we have to be consistent, yeah, with the point of, let's say, our missionary objective, yeah, in educating, enabling, enlightening, empowering, and so on, yeah. But we have also to acknowledge, yeah, that higher education also, to some extent, yeah, fail, yeah, to meet, yeah, the workplace job market needs, yeah. And also, I have to say that our higher education also have to apologize for any kind of, let's say, wrongdoings made by our alumni. Yeah, this is also the reality. Yeah, in almost developing countries, yeah, this kind of abuses of power, corruption, and so on are still exist. So this is the reality again, that our higher education to some extent should say sorry about this. Yeah. And of course, as advised or suggested by Professor Lee, we need adjustment, flexibility, yeah, and so on. Yeah. And also adapt and adopt the IT development. But I'm still having the question, and I think it is still valid to raise, yeah, our higher education, yeah, are our institutions is a civilizing agencies, yeah, or just part of the business, yeah. This is also another issue that still relevant to be raised, and still in the process to be discussed further. Yeah. Having said that, this one, I'm going to say thank you very much for listening, yeah, the idea, the concern, or the problems that we have here in Parahyangan Catholic University, universities in Indonesia in general. And we are very eager to hear from you, your comment, or any other kind of best practices from other universities in Thailand, Malaysia, Philippines, and other places. So thank you very much. Thank you. Back to you, Madam Moderator. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bapak Rektor. We see questions already in the chat box, but we are going to compile them. We are going to go to the second speaker immediately. Our second speaker is a professor and also a Dato, Professor Emeritus Dato Insinyur Dr. Zainai bin Mohamed. Professor Mohamed obtained his Bachelor and Master of Science in Civil Engineering from University of Strathclyde, Scotland, and his PhD is from University of Cambridge. Professor Zainai's expertise is in civil structural engineering, higher education management, entrepreneurship education, and strategic management. We can see from the screen his experience. And Professor Mohammed's presentation today will be on future and post-COVID-19 pandemic of higher education, enablers for success. Professor, the camera is yours.
Thank you. I need to upload sharing the document. Can you allow me to share the document?
You can do it now, Professor.
Okay, thank you. Okay. Thank you, Madam Moderator, and thanks our colleague down in the host of this seminar, particularly Yang Terhormat Bapak Rektor.
Thank you, Pak Dato.
Yeah, of course, our colleague from Asian Learning Network members from Philippines, Thailand, Vietnam, Indonesia, and so on. Of course, the lovely participant who joined in this group today. My subject today is actually partly as a continuity of the our previous speaker. Without realizing that we are, the secretary arranging the subject matters accordingly. So those are subject been mentioned about issue and challenges. I would not repeat too much about that, but I would like to share with you some of these because we realize that the novel virus, coronavirus, actually a pandemic that touches many more sectors of life. So no exception for higher education. So in other words, that it is unpredictable kind of thing at the end result, and also variable in outcomes. So how do we handle this? So I would say that to handle this for higher education and post-pandemic, it's very much on the higher education should be more flexible to change, and the success will be based on the enablers. I mean, set of enablers that I will identify with you, the ability to adapt and adapt. So in this case, I will focus on that one more. Because when we say something, organization or group to be success, so we have to ensure that we understand who and what are the enablers behind that thing, behind the success. So the presentation today outline is I will start briefly on the first two, three slides because it's mentioned already, even the change is inevitable. And then I go direct to the more focus and detail to institutional enablers. And how do we handle that one, where be possible? So before I go on, because I'm still a staff with the University of Technology Malaysia, I take you 1, 2, 3 pages to visit UTM. This is very quick. We are with 7 faculties in place, and then organized since transformed since 2018. The biggest is Faculty of Engineering, constitute about 50-55% of the total university. So because we are engineering technology based institute. So this is some of the fact that you need no need to read this because some small one, but this is the size of university. We have about 24,000 students, some 8,000 or 9,000 are postgraduate, and 14,000 is undergraduate, and some about close to 4,500 international students. We are research universities in Malaysia, one of the 5. And then we have about 4,500 staff, and then 1,700 of them are academician. This is about global ranking, because when you are in the group of research university for and so on, they normally refer to and going to see what is your global ranking kind of thing. These are the current one is just published until 2021. We are ranked Asia in number 46. For world university ranking, we are 187. And then of course the others are down there. So in other words, I'm going to browse through with you the presentation today about that subject I put in the synopsis just now. I'm sorry for some of this slide very crowded because I want to put everything in one page. But I bold some of them. That's what the subject to say so or to explore further. Higher education challenges. The trend of economic and also about this digital age, the mentioned by our colleague, and also about the reason for speed and accessibility is become our challenges. I will say more about that one. Event of COVID-19 pandemic, this is an event. It is a crisis or disasters kind of thing. We need to enter into new normal. These are the main issue that we discussed by our colleague just now. When we say that it is an event, we need that something that cannot be reversible anymore. So you could say that the outbreak can be anywhere and the risk can be everywhere. So this is an issue that quite different with a normal disaster. But in general, when I said disaster, it's a kind of crisis. It's normally unpredictable, okay? Otherwise, it's not called as a disaster. So in our higher education outcome, we always become agenda in business of higher education. We focus on graduate quality and employability about the need by the industry, the need by the stakeholders, and many more other things. So this is a challenge to us. And some of those challenges already in place. And then we know that the biggest global issue is a continued erosion of trust. That's another one, meaning that something that underlines something wrong with our system and higher education. This is said by the Klaus Schwab from World Economic Forum kind of thing. So we can say many more of outcome, good outcome. But one that very important is the issue of the what do you call the erosion of trust from our graduate or from our outcome. On international issue of higher education agenda, today we talk that we are in a global environment, so international competitive is a kind of thing that measure. But how could we assume that the international student, for example, now we find that still a value for them to have intercultural experience of study abroad? We are not sure now, as an institution, your institution, our institution, or many other institutions, because the mobility problem now is become an issue. This is the kind of thing. Maybe they decided you are not need to have another what we call this new experience in learning. Just stay back and stay at their hometown or whatever we can say that in their nation. So this is a challenge for us. That the scenario we focus so much for long already about that internationalization, but now come to the this issue, the issue of difficulty to what we call it. To go beyond the boundary physically, and then also about teaching through a partnership or international partners also become an issue now. This is issue in challenges and scenario in internationalization of higher education. I think what I try to focus and say more is to emphasize what our colleague mentioned just now. So see that the virus case in Malaysia, this is just very quick. You see that we are able to, what do we call condom, to not to say to stop, but to manage it within short time. But we hope that this in Malaysia specifically, we continue to maintain or sustain and able to control it. You see, it began just in March, but it almost diminishes, not really complete, by July. It shoot up and down, but one more that very important here, you see that suddenly here, people will question if you discuss this matter. This is the one that from a group of people, they are in what do you call this, in control. They are, what do you call this, migrant people. So that we can condemn, we can control them. So when we control, the issue is coming down again. So in total, you can see that the active cases drop down so much and continue to drop. We hope that we are able to maintain. So if this case continue, we are able to be in that way. So how do we handle this? So we have to think about, we have to use the philosophy of managing the disasters in this case, or managing the crisis. This is very important. This is health disaster, not the natural, what do you call it, man-made disaster. It's about health disaster more than man-made, whatever we can think of. So in Malaysia, we have system of managing those. We call it movement control order, or in general term, we call it lockdown kind of thing. We have stages from the strict movement order to conditional movement order to recovery movement order. Now we are in the recovery stage already in Malaysia scene. So the management of this movement control order is a Nobel by itself for Malaysia, because we succeed to do it as what we thought best. And then we deliver it. So the main features of these disasters or pandemic, actually unpredictable and variable in terms of outcome. So we are very difficult to predict exactly on what the outcome like and so on. So the life is not only the individual, not about the individual focus, but about the caring to others, care about neighbors, care about our friend, care about so on. So it's not very good to be individual focused in our way of doing things now. We should focus also our partners, our friends, and so on. So that is pandemic issue. So I bring you one of these slides that I used it before for other things. You see that when we are in this situation, actually we are managing the disaster. But there is a model, I call it disaster zone model here in management. When it is chaotic, it is a beginning, it is a very, very difficult day when we are first meet with the pandemic. So we are in this zone. Now we are coming to new normal, but may not come to the old normal here. This is before, this is after. You see that this after, we don't know what going to be the last. Sometimes people call post-disasters kind of thing. So because of that, from the United Nations kind of statement before and so on, when we are in this management approach, we call it, we're going to do building back better kind of zone after this one or post-pandemic. So we have to do some kind of recovery. We have to do some kind of reconstruction. So in other words, how to do it? You must identify the enablers then. You must identify the reason and also the factors, important factor, critical factor to move forward. That's the kind of thing. So the challenges then very much about, I've give you one area of challenges in our higher education. It's about teaching and learning because of this pandemic. This is about the game changing even now because of this pandemic. So our focus, our thinking, our goal for a long time as a fundamental for our life in academic or in higher education, we talk about effective teaching and learning. this has challenged us now because of this issue. So we have to embark on multi-mode of delivery now. That's a very, very simple to say, but it's not that easy to be effective. We call it sometimes blended learning kind of thing, able to try to be a student-focused kind of where possible. In UTM, we have some kind of initiative we call it New Academia Learning Innovative, NALI, which we given attention to readiness of the learners, meaning that we have to think about, when we said the readiness here is also cover for now, which is during the pandemic time now, is about ability to access, to connect to the internet. Because Malaysia also is not a fully covered internet coverage in Malaysia. For our students, we experience about 10-12% that not able to do good connectivity. That's a become issue. So we have to focus on them. Also about new teaching skill. So this is an issue fall under our, for example, this is our teachers. I mean our academic group, academic fraternity. Because like the one we heard just now, Professor Rector also mentioned about, and then also Professor Chong mentioned about, we are new in doing this digital technology in teaching and learning. We, meaning that the one who are 65 old years old and above. I'm also coming to 70, so it's in the group that really not normally use this. But now we have to use it. So not just talking about the rigid time now, meaning attending the class together, sitting together, or you do it online together. We call it sometimes synchronous, but we could do it. We could think about possibility of asynchronous kind of thing, but using the technology kind. So another main issue also, we have to understand that we have different learning styles from the young one. One could be or do better with a visual kind of thing because they've been developed through that kind of thing. They need to see things before they learn. Some of those very good at hearing. You know, the one who like to hear thing, they just put an eye open, ear open, and hear it and follow it, the argument or whatever the thing input through it. But more importantly now, there are a group of people, they like kinesthetic kind of thing. Do it, see it together, see? That sometimes we interpret as a teacher, as a lecturer, we call it a learning by doing kind of thing. Experiential learning at end of the result. So how do we handle this? We miss that kind of thing during the time now, the recovery time, but also we may miss also for the future one because the other part, our party is not ready to participate together what we need. So in other words, that we still need to say that we need to hold that the quality of outcome is our main agenda. We don't want to compromise on that. So the main issue, for example, I mentioned to you here, is about the student to have industrial experience, difficult with that. And then also contextual learning, because they are not able to go through the normal way of mobility, experience by himself, by themselves. Then it is because of limited accessibility because of this pandemic. So we have to be aware of that kind of thing. So in other words, the next part, I will say that the change for us in inevitable is mentioned by Prof. Chong just now. We have to be ready to be changed and must be flexible for the change. New normal require us to do many more things. For example, the term social distancing is used widely now. But sometimes people don't understand what in our area of concern, in this case, in our higher education. So we have to think about how to handle that.
Professor, you have 3 minutes.
Oh yeah, very short then. So we have to capitalize virtual spaces. virtual space, meaning that the one online kind of thing. And then we have to think about new skill, learn how to learn. So we have to do it through that one. So in other words, we have to reset the button for the higher education. I go on through. So the enablers here for higher education I identify is prominent there. Because higher education, we can think about it is as an organic organization. So meaning that they have soul, they have a body. So we have to handle that one. But we think to have a healthy growth of higher education. So in other words, we have to handle the enablers. These are the enablers, I would say that, reasonably to put together to handle the higher education transformation, in particular during this the effect of this pandemic. So it's about people. You must think about people first and about their culture. About tool and technology, we mentioned already. About partnership, everybody mentioned now, partnership is important. About institutional system and process, internal process, internal system, we have to adjust ourselves. Might be transformed, might be redeployed, might be whatever you name it. And then about leadership and communication is very important now. So these are the uniqueness of them, but still whatever thing that they are speed dependent, they are timing and contextual. So you have to choose a proper time and so on and proper environment. But it is an interdisciplinary kind of thing, but always influenced by other factors which beyond our control, political, economic, social issue, technology issue, legal environment. You must be careful on this one. We need change, we want to change, but sometimes that other also influenced. We would like to change because of this situation. So about people, I mentioned to you already, we have to strengthen up our team of provider, meaning that this one academic fraternity, that the people who are provided the higher education, our team. And also we have to think about learners, the importance of them, and also about stakeholder, and also the culture of rejecting, the culture of negative, we have to be improve on that one. And then also, of course, another enabler is a collaboration and partnership. I mentioned quickly on this because it is about synergy. When we say synergy, it's enough to tell us that it is very important. 1 + 2, the concept of synergy is greater than 3. Might be 3 the minimum, but maybe more than 3. So we could say that do more with less kind of thing. Okay? And the rest of those are one of the things that probably borderless team members also be possible to be under this kind of collaboration and partnership, and then we'll be possible to do it. These some of the benefit of our partnership. You can read that the 10 benefit for collaborators on the right here. Whether you are talking about giving via sustainability issue, or you're talking about professional issue, you're talking about talent development, and so on. These are collected to be 10 very basic benefit to the collaborators.
You can copy, yeah.
And then about technology, I don't want to mention because we mentioned it, and everybody mentioned it. Institutional system and processes. I would say that simple to say that we have to check the one what we practice inside from the previous one. For example, the term in Malaysia we use, in particular in one of the example in the UTM as well, of course face-to-face is a normal one. We have to do it online delivery. We have to use blended, we have to use minimal thing. And then we have to introduce minimal initiative such that it is ready to capture the difficulty. That one only inside, we have to control that one. Inside our institution, no other place. But we'll be careful with the external issue. And of course, the process and workflow, because to improve effectiveness and so on. And then clear governance. We don't want to have things that havoc again inside the institution. And then leadership, of course, leadership is influenced by many more things, but of course we need someone that very clear mission and vision in terms of what to handle during this difficult time. And of course, they are guided by certain principles. And of course, we talk that we would like to have provide a skill, life skill for those the learners. That's our long-term vision in terms of leadership. And then we would like to see that the leaders at this stage, at this time, are able to swim in the turbulent period. For example, that leader is not walking the talk. That is not good. We would like to have leadership that lack of conviction. We don't want to have that. Leaders with no clear purpose and passion. So this is what that in oppose the good leadership what we would like to do. So the preferred solution that I say that I suggest to you what to do, you must clear ourselves about what the desired outcome in higher education with the new pandemic and the post-pandemic here. So we have to focus on that those enablers, that those set are given, and then we have to know that what are the critical success factor that drive that enabler. And then from there on, we create the initiative to deliver that enabler. So the journey of preferred solution is rough, it's difficult, but of course, this, if you see this, this is a kind of proper plan. It's a strategic exercise for those who are in the management team to think about, review about, revisit about your way of deliberating. So this is self-explained, because whatever you have the enablers, you have to have critical success factor and initiative to move forward. And then you are looking for the preferred solution if you can predict in next 5 years, 2 years, 5 years, 10 years time. That's the way forward. So in other words, also we have to think about this simple what I call summary, which I put to you. It is about, we need something that properly strategized, properly structured, and in place of good system. Then we can move forward and to deliver the what thing. And then we are focusing on the success through the enablers that I mentioned to you. As a conclusion, it is a issue of what mentioned by everybody. It's a pandemic, the COVID-19 pandemic is a an event of no ambiguity, and then no reversible. Might be repeating possible, but you cannot reverse back to the old normal too much, but we have to think about new normal. So you need to do it through effective strategic management process and procedure and practices, which you have to assess those elements, those enablers through strategic reassessment analysis process, and a lot of what if question to ask, such that we are able to control this unpredictability issue in terms of the time ahead, as well as the variability of outcome. So in other words, we have to prepare ourselves. We are the team for higher education deliverable, so we have to prepare that time. For that note, I think thank you very much for the time given, and thanks the host University UNPAR for giving me the opportunity to do this. To deliver some of my talk about the subject matters, future and post-COVID higher education, what we should do to continue to be successful. Thank you very much.
Terima kasih, Prof.
Yep.
Thank you, Professor. Really interesting presentation. I wished that we have more time to discuss it. I might want to contact you to discuss it later. We have questions in line also already. We are compiling the questions, but now we'll move to the third speaker. Our third speaker is very Reverend Aloysius Maranan OSB. Reverend Father Maranan is currently director and president of San Beda University in the Philippines. Reverend Maranan has AB in economics at San Beda University, Philippines, licentiate of canon law at University of Santo Tomas, Philippines, MA in theological studies at Maryhill School of Theology, Philippines, and PhD in education at the La Salle University, Philippines. He has the experience of more than 40 years in education, and his expertise is on educational planning and development, strategic visioning and goal setting for institutions of learning, and classroom supervisions and management. Today, Reverend Father Maranan's presentation is on transitioning to the new normal, education challenges, initiatives, and prospects, the case of San Beda University. Father, the camera is yours.
Thank you very much, Dr. Silvia. Good morning, my dear friends and participants of the ALN, to our host university, the Parangyangan Catholic University of Bandung, Indonesia, to my esteemed fellow presenters and speakers of the international webinar, friends, ladies and gentlemen, prior to COVID-19 pandemic, many universities have comfortably engaged in the fast-paced requirements of educational transformation brought about by technological advancement. But today, as we look around at the effects of COVID-19 pandemic around the world, we see the unexpected and the unintended challenges that have sharply bothered institutions of higher learning. At the start of this year's global COVID-19 outbreak, UNESCO has estimated that over 1.2 billion learners have been affected in various ways, or 70% of the world's student population. These are due to sudden lockdown and temporary closures of schools and universities. In our country here in the Philippines, amidst the pandemic, the President of the Republic has articulated the importance of appropriate measures and regulations by all concerned agencies to address the debilitating effect of health crisis
on
the education sector. And looking beyond under this new normal, he emphasized that the future of this nation depends on how we navigate the education of our young people towards the new normal. So then, what lies ahead? We may ask ourselves. So I have listed here before you in our PowerPoint three challenges, but you can add some more. For San Beda University, I am noting three important challenges: the challenge of fleeting transition, the challenge of economic survival, and the challenge of facet assurance of standard of outcome. The challenge of fleeting transition comes, simply put, in a very broad spectrum. The challenges encountered by higher education nowadays, coupled with the uncertainty of moving forward, can be summed up in this multifaceted process of fleeting transition. With the pandemics, we have planned the unequivocal change our methodology from the traditional practice of classroom learning to massive virtual learning platforms. So we have crafted a lot of blended and flexible delivery methods and develop online curriculum delivery plans. The fleeting challenge of transition comes when our collective concern is focused on how certain is the transition, the when, the where, and the how of quality and competent delivery of learning can be accomplished at all levels with fleeting time. However, I can surmise, how prepared are the technological infrastructures? How inclined are the teachers to handle the new platforms? And the learners themselves, how ready are they to respond to the new normal? To the challenge of economic survival, in the Philippines, last academic year 2019-2020, there were around 30.7 million learners in the country, with 27.8 learners in elementary and high school and 2.9 learners enrolled in higher education, according to the survey of our COCOPEA. The international impacts of the pandemic have been seriously felt economically by all sectors of the country, but most severely also in the education sector due to recession and unemployment. An increasing number of our overseas Filipino workers losing their jobs abroad, local employees and laborers being laid off. They bring heavy problems in their family financial resources. And this means corresponding decrease on families' resources to basically pay the cost of education. And so the multifaceted challenge of economic survival looms on the horizon. Number three, on the challenge of facile assurance of standard of and quality of outcome. At the outset, the challenges noted include identifying workable solutions to carry out the delivery of education and the development of human character during the new normal. As in the case of other universities in the country, San Beda faces critical challenge of compliance to the standards set by the national advisories from the Department of Education, the Commission on Higher Education, and the other important allied government agencies. Foremost challenge is the assurance of quality outcome of education during the transition from the traditional face-to-face instruction to massive virtual and remote learning platforms. The challenge involves the primary task of standardizing the university's institutional structures, the system capability to minimize the ill effects and to maximize the benefits amidst the crisis. The challenge calls for mitigating the unintended effects of directly unsupervised method of learning on the holistic development of learners as an essential parameter in the assurance of quality and standards of the new normal learning environment. Next slide, please. For the initiatives, I am proposing three important initiatives. One is the opportunity for maximizing virtual technology. Two, an increased collaboration and unity in engagement. And three, an expanded and intensive program on distance learning. On the maximization of virtual technology, these are being fully implemented through webinar meetings and online trainings. What we have now is an example of maximizing virtual technology. All these have global reach and are observed to be beneficial to all. So aside from individual initiatives, private organizations and the Philippine government agencies have sponsored massive training of all teachers on flexible learning options. Hopefully, this will really materialize. Second, both public and government officials have mediated on reduced rates and complementary access of internet services. This is still being worked out also by our government. And thirdly, provide subsidies and loans for students and faculty on the acquisition of computers and other gadgets in line with the Republic Act 10650. But this one is very selective in the nature of the learners. And fourth, but not the least, is the extended financial assistance to teachers and school personnel. On the second initiative, the increased collaboration and unity engagement under the new normal, where international bilateral partnerships and networks affiliations have become more actively open with the ease of access through virtual communications. in the Philippines, in our country, recent surveys conducted by our COCOPEIA revealed that majority of the universities, together with private and governmental institutions, are selflessly and collaboratively rolling out flexible online learning, preparing the infrastructure requirements, and ensuring services of telecoms for internet activity and connectivity. On the third initiative about the expanded and intensive program, San Beda University, the transition process comprises innovations focused on strengthening the academic workforce through an expanded and intensive program on distance learning modalities. For example, our Integrated Basic Education Department aligns itself with the guidelines and advisories of the Learning Continuity Plan of our Department of Education. Similarly, our professional and graduate school levels exceed the mandated national guidelines and framework for the integration of flexible learning modalities, so that our university leadership has worked closely with external offices in providing what we call the necessary landscape befitting an education that is effective and excellent in delivery towards the new normal. Next slide, please. Prospect. We have identified three major prospects. One, the growing international opportunities. Second, the fluid advancement in virtual education with greater efficiency. And third, roadmap to a pivotal global digital university. Number one prospect is the growing international opportunities worldwide, shown by increasing numbers for partnerships from here on into the future. This could be beyond mere university collaborations, but among academic, private, and government sectors collaboration through technology. Number two, the fluid advancement in the area of virtual education with expected greater efficiency in service of companies and technology providers, expertise of educators and industry practitioners. This could lead to a more responsive higher education vis-a-vis the Education Revolution 5.0 to meet employment needs from here on to the future. Our third prospect that we see is that for San Beda, and just like your university and many other universities here in Asia, most especially, part of our university journey is the pivotal roadmap to become a global digital university. There is no turning back. This current state of affairs is to some extent expediting our transition efforts urgently and positively. As Rector was saying earlier, thank you, COVID, but not to you, but only to the cause which are very intended for us. Because in transitioning, we have international programs and activities. The past years with partners and networks, we have expanded online collaborations. We have lined up programs for e-lecture series. We have e-research matching. We have e-outreach. We have the e-research presentations, the e-workshops and trainings, among others. And for example, for some time now, we have online collaborative activities. To mention a few, we have already existing collaborative activities with UMK and UNIB this past years. And we look forward on having more with other members of our ASEAN Learning Network. And so, in conclusion, our next slide, please. In conclusion, my dear educators of Asia, of ASEAN Learning Network, there could be a lot more models and framework that you can propose and suggest in facing the new normal after this pandemic. But what matters is how we navigate our new normal chart to survive and to thrive beyond the COVID-19 pandemic. We have to be globally united. We have to be networkly dedicated. And ASEAN countries must harmoniously be committed to work together as one ASEAN learning community, because we are not isolated islands. We become stronger, we become happier and richer when we share the bountiful goods of education, especially to the marginalized member of our young students, our young people who are the hope of each and every nation. Here in ASEAN Learning Network, we express our gratitude for the evolving paradigm of how education can truly be an effective vehicle and agent of change in our region and most especially in our country. As in our other goal is to work hand in hand to become more humane, more understanding, and more compassionate member as we respond to the call of truthful and peaceful service to the marginalized sector of humanity. So let this begin with the ALN, that whatever would be the outcome of the COVID-19 pandemic, the ASEAN Learning Network will provide a way of giving hope, initiatives, and prospects to our young people. Thank you very much for listening, and mabuhay po kayong lahat. God bless.
Thank you.
Very much, Father. Thank you.
Mabuhay, Reverend Father. We are entering the question and answer session now. If you have any question that you would like to express directly, you can raise your hand. You can click the participants icon, and there you can click raise hand, or we can go to the questions written in the chat. Let me see. Yeah. While waiting for the question to be up. Yeah, it's up now. We have questions from Dr. Raman Ricardo Roque. What are some of the best practices in ensuring that students maintain complete focus and attention during online classes? And then how can we make online learning and lectures more engaging despite the distance gap between professor and students? I guess we are all facing this. And the next question is to Pamangadar. He has answered in the chat, but I think we will be benefiting from a longer answer for this from Professor Farouk Zakaria from Prince of Songkhla University, Pattani, Thailand. My question is, how do you address those human values such as sincerity in this virtual world whereby everything is uncertain when people are connected through machines? And some say that we are turning into machines. The interaction, the social interaction is not available anymore. We do have more questions. Yes, there's another one. What can networks like ALN contribute in responding to the challenges of the universities due to the pandemic? How can the network of schools help higher education institutions persevere online learning, and especially now that we acknowledge the challenges of doing experience-based learning? And this is from Fritzi de Ferrat from the La Salle University. We will settle with these three questions first. Who would like to answer first? Bapak Mangadar, Would you like to go first?
Yes, okay. Thank you, Madam Moderator, and thank you to the question raised. So I will come from the last question, yeah, with about the aisle and contribution, yeah, to support online learning. Well, this issue seems to be rightly discussed in the executive committee meeting yesterday about our program within ILN, because we talk about the benefit, let's say such word, yeah, the benefit of our network to our institutions member and also to non-members institution. So I think again, if you talk about the ILN as a network, it might be a good idea if, let's say, lecturers within ILN institutional members can develop a kind of, let's say, common, not common platform, but common, let's say, materials, yeah, in certain subject, yeah. And I guess Professor Lee Choi, as our executive director, is very eager to support this kind of idea that our institution can create or develop again materials in certain subjects to be shared each other, yeah, let's say in social enterprises or in economic development issues. So we make it a kind of, let's say, collaboration in effect, in reality. So in that point again, sharing the idea, let's say we have an expert from San Beda, from De La Salle, from Taksin, or from Prince of Sokland University, or from Malaysia, yeah, work together and create a kind of, let's say, joint materials to be delivered in our own institution. This is also a good idea in supporting, again, our students, and also in responding to the one we talk about online learning process in the pandemic situation. This is a very rough idea, need to talk, of course, further about this one, but I guess, again, that ILN should be more contributive in this issue. That's the point. And to Professor Farouk, I thought we have already chat, yeah, about the idea to ensure about the human values, yeah, in our online learning process, online process, how to make it happen or to be delivered, yeah, about sincerity, about integrity, honesty, and so on. So, well, I have to say at this time, yeah, my sharing is that we try to be felt present, to be felt by our student that we are caring of them, yeah, in this difficult situation, yeah, by keeping contact, yeah, keeping in touch with our student about anything related to the student problem, about study or about daily life, yeah, we need to make sure that our students are well, are in a good condition. But when we talk about our curriculum programs, about again, to make this kind of, let's say, human values to be part of our online learning process, I have to say again, we are still working hard on this issue. We raise the same concern about this, yeah, how to keep our student, yeah, a very, let's say, tough person, disciplined one, responsible one, yeah, and very eager to develop him or herself
Yeah, all this kind of, let's say, human values, yeah, universal skills, soft skills that we need to, again, to increase or to make them, again, being enabled in such kind of human values. I don't have any strict or clear formula or answer to this question again, but we do believe that this one about human values is a very fundamental issue when you talk about online learning. Yeah. And I saw Professor Dato Jainai already quote, yeah, cited an idea that in the, let's say, it is, I said before, the biggest, yeah, global issue in related to the revolution industry 4.0 is the erosion, yeah, the continued erosion of trust. So again, seems to be a big challenge, as Father Aloy also said, yeah, for us to make this issue be addressed, yeah, very well, properly by our university. I'm going to say that it seems to be that universities is no longer as the agency for knowledge transfer. Yeah, because we have already such kind of, let's say, option or alternative through a massive open online resources about knowledge. So the university is no longer, yeah, to be claimed as an institution for transferring knowledge. But what we have to keep again is about the idea that higher education institutions is a part of the civilization agency, cultural institution, that we are putting attention very much on these human values in such kind of soft skills. So again, big challenge for us. Yeah. And of course, Professor Ricardo, yeah, thank you also from the question. We share each other. Yeah. I don't have any idea. I'm not an expert in such kind of, let's say, technicalities or technology in running online, yeah, teaching or education. But we have colleagues, yeah, we have friends in my own university who try to develop again the better platform or the best mechanism, yeah, to ensure that the student can get more focused, pay attention, yeah, during the online classes, yeah. The engagement of the student is very essential one, yeah. I saw they try to do some sort of interactive process, yeah, discussion and dialogue, yeah, to ask the student to get involved, yeah. This is the one I saw a big challenge also on creating a more interactive online teaching or learning process. That's all I can answer at this moment. So thank you very much for such important question raised. Thank you, Madam Moderator.
Thank you, Bapak Mangadar. For sure, engagement, maintaining engagement is not giving them more assignments, ya, Pak?
Yes.
Okay. We'll go to Professor Zainai. Professor.
Yes. You hear me now?
Yep. Yes. Yep.
Yeah, I have few points to add into the Bapak Mangadar just now about the question. In general, I would say that the big question that by Dr. Raymond Ricardo, actually everybody asking about the same question now, because we are involved in the teaching and doing the learning for the student. One thing that physically people say that when you're doing on the online, the duration, actually, you need to limit that 1 point, because that, as human, we can't do it better than more than 1 hour kind of thing of full attention. Normally, that's why people took it as a gender now. I mean, normality is about 50 minutes is the best attention time or focus time. But you could extend it to say that 2 hours by having some kind of interactive between. So, because they learn by doing kind of thing, because by giving some short assignment and engagement through a short question, discussion kind of thing, then you can take it about as long as 2 hours kind of thing. So if directly one way of information transferring, I think not more than 1 hour. It's difficult. I mean, general studies show that people not giving the focus, attention, if that. So we have, as educators, we have to create the environment online such that everybody would like to do some work or contribute. Maybe you are grouping them into 2 person, 3 person. Let's discuss this, and the other one discuss the other one. Meaning we have to create that. Actually, the discussion is for the extension of knowledge, for the extension knowledge analysis based on certain issues, such that they can explore more. And then also this is what called active learning kind of thing. So you can do it longer hours, more than 1 hour, for example. However, there are other things that I group the question about human values and about human, the values factors in this case. Of course, everybody talk about industrial revolution, actually changing from human to the machine kind of thing, or from manual to digital kind of thing. That people say so. I mean, generally people say so. But always we must remember that as we are, as a people who can think about, the machine can't do more than human. But in certain aspect, they do it. As overall, they not do everything, the machines. People can do more. In particular, about judgment, machine not doing the judgment. Machine doing what we specify. They're not going to tolerate on the specification kind of thing. Very precision kind of work, no? But human, they can judge whether that one is really good or bad or thing, whatever thing. That's a human value must be there. So that's why in one of my slides, I would say that some issue of this, what do you call this, today and many more years back already, people talk about value education coming into that. You know that in our education, people say that entrepreneurship education inside. People said about human, generally all human, see? So another term now coming up, and then very popular, seem that it's acceptable to make sure that human always there in function as what we talk. So human education, meaning that during the process, whatever subject you are in going to be specialized, we touch on human issues, human sensitivity kind of thing. That's why people said also the value given by this descriptors in the what you call the global citizens values, I put in my slide also down there, is a factor that we should give in attention to. So another one point is, as Bapa Rector mentioned just now, is about, we talked about yesterday, the mooted ideas about global classroom. I mean, reviewing the global classroom by the group organization, like network organization like we are today. It probably we have to create a new kind of global classroom for the members or learners to experience this. Maybe the classroom center in Malaysia, they can bring in into Malaysian experience, Malaysian culture probably, a Malaysian way of doing things for the certain problem. Then this is given an opportunity for other friends around the globe to learn about Malaysian way of doing things, in other words. If we are focusing from center from Malaysia as the classroom that we created. Indonesia may create one of the global classroom that offers something that the special that probably not easy to get it, but have to learn it. So in that kind of thing, it's possible. But the only thing when we are dealing with higher education, that one probably we can do best for the subject matters of general education kind of thing. When it comes to specific, I would say that we have to find ways how to handle it. Might be specific, like for example, we're talking about engineering education. How to deliver the engineering specialization subject. Probably that one we have to improve our way of doing things now together, and then we may share and whatever we can do best. I think that's what I can offer on this general three questions. Thank you very much, Madam Facilitator.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Sir, Reverend Father.
Can you hear me?
Yes. Clearly.
Okay. For the three questions from Dr. Cardi Roque, from Professor Farouk, and from Professor Ritzy, you know, at this time when our educational institutions have become engrossed through technological advancement, the more that we, the adults, the teachers, the faculty, must be concerned about the development of human soft skill, the interpersonal relationship, and our love for one another and for our country and for other people. For example, for the question of Dr. Cardi Roque, although he is my colleague, my friend in San Beda, but also I suppose I could help some other professors in other universities. While we want to have focus of our children inside the online classes, we must put premium towards development of human personal touch. For example, that our work online must get towards creative, critical thinking, that it must lead to a more important events in our life where we shall develop understanding, reflection of the things that we do. In short, we must be goal and objective oriented, that more than just being engaged is that we know what we are doing. Similarly, we become more engaged while becoming in distance gap. We may be distantly away from one another, but if our behavior, our words, our actions are expression of support, of compassion, of love, of help and service, of justice to the poor and the marginalized member of society, for those who cannot avail of the gadgets, then maybe we can help the online distance learning a way of lifting up the human spirit of our young people, where we know that right now we are in the midst of depression, we are in the midst of mental health, and our young people need to be supported in the best way possible that we can give them. For Professor Farouk, about the issue of how do we address human values such as sincerity in virtual world, you know, many times Professor Farouk and myself have interacted and communicated, but let us remind ourselves that human values remain simply a concept or a word until they are behaviorally expressed towards our fellow human being. So that you can only be said to be sincere when you have interacted with a fellow human being. Other values of sincerity, honesty, compassion, love, care, forgiveness, support, and all the values that the ALN are looking forward, this can only be expressed towards another human being. And so the important thing is, while we may be distant from our school, but inside our house, among our friends, then let us apply, let us teach them to apply what we are learning towards online classes. And for Dr. Fritz, I think the important thing here is what the ALN can contribute to the different members or the different universities. And I invite everyone to join the ALN because there are a lot of future and hope in the ALN, is the consortium, our ability to share our resources, our ability to share our teachers and faculty, our ability to share our knowledge. And when we mutually support one another, we support, but most especially towards who are underprivileged, those who are marginalized, those who cannot afford what we have. That is one way that ALN can truly be proud of its name of supporting the social enterprise and economic development of our region. Thank you.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Father. Yeah, about that compassion, I remember I ended our last semester in UNPAR with one student crying because for her, being in the online class is like an escape from all the worriness, all the stress of being locked inside her home. So yeah, we need to keep in touch with the students. So yeah, because we have limited time, I would like to highlight some keywords, not necessarily sentences. Technology is important. Collaboration is needed, of course. Enabling and empowering needs to be done. And strategy needs to be formalized. And of course, we need to stay focused on the objective of higher education institutions. With that note, I would like to ask you all to join me in giving applause to the three speakers. Thank you, Bapak Mangadar Situmorang, Dato' Zainai Muhammad, and Father Aloysius Maranan. After this, we are going to have another session, but before we continue with the next session, we'll give you time to take a short break. 5 minutes, maybe running somewhere. we cannot sit for the whole 4 hours, stretch a little bit. And before we move to the next session, I'm Sylvia Yazid. I would like to thank you for joining this session because the next session will be hosted by my colleague. Thank you very much. And in Indonesian, we usually say mohon maaf if there was any mistakes or any weaknesses in conducting this session. And terima kasih. Terima kasih thank banyak.
Thank you.
For the break, please enjoy the presentation from our students, a dance from Listra Unpar.
Thank you, Dr. Sylvia. Thank you. Thank you for
Okay, Wilujeng Sumping in the Sundanese language. Selamat datang and welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the second session of ALN International Webinar, Surviving and Thriving Beyond the COVID Pandemic, Charting the New Normal, hosted by Parahyangan Catholic University. Let me introduce myself. My name is Fernando Mulia. I'm a lecturer at Parahyangan Catholic University. We will now begin our second session with the sub-theme, Charting the New Normal. We'll know that the current condition focus on force us to have new normal. 1 year ago, almost none of us ever think about this new normal. Last year around this time, I was in San Beda, Philippines for international lecturing series with my fellow friends San Beda here also. I told the audience that we will have the new normal someday in the future, that we will work from home and do most anything sometime in the future, anytime. But I never imagined that day come this March. Even for us, we have never imagined that we will hosting international webinar like this with more than 500 registered users and from more than 10 countries, namely Indonesia, Malaysia, Philippines, Thailand, Vietnam, Iraq, India, Timor-Leste, Switzerland, Madagascar, and so on. Yes, we will survive this pandemic. These two will pass. Just like Prof. Chong said in the first session, change is necessary to keep ourselves survive. This session will have three speakers from three countries, from three different area expertise to broaden our perspective. Our first speaker is Professor Dr. Saleh Abdul Rashid. Prof. Saleh is already with us. Prof. Saleh currently is the director of the Center for Sustainable Academic Leadership Development, University Malaysia Perlis. Prof. Saleh finished his bachelor in University Science Malaysia and has his Master of Science and PhD from University of Manchester. Prof. Saleh's expertise is on education and human behavior development. Prof. Saleh has several experience such as dean, mental trainer, and also researcher on human behavior. Today, Prof. Saleh's presentation will be on tech competency-based education, a call for action following post-COVID-19. Prof. Saleh, the spotlight is yours. Prof. Saleh?
Yep. Okay. So I cannot see my face, I think. Hello, everyone. Assalamualaikum and a very good evening. It's almost 2 o'clock in Malaysia. I hope I can be cleared as I could. Before you start off the screen, let me give a warm welcome from University of Malaysia Perlis. We are more known as UNIMAP, MAP, it says UNIMAP. I think a very familiar face. Kemarin nampak muka Ibu Sylvia, hari ini nampak lagi. before I start my presentation, I'd like to echo with the few questions from the first session. Right, when we are saying about online learning, please understand that we are actually dealing with basic and incomplete technologies when we are embarking into our online learning. And none of us been trained to teach online before as we are trained to be a lecturers. So everybody are struggling, try to best, looking for the best way to deliver online. I try to answer by chatting on the other side by looking at the question posed by our colleague. We also having the same problem. I think the main thing about online learning is not a teaching online, but actually teaching through the line, meaning you are not on screen, you are teaching through the screen. So you have to have a different perspective when you are embarking into online education. And the heroes for online learning is not the one who doing live teaching, but the one who doing a lot of asynchronous learning, meaning that you need to provide more guided learning to the student. Guided learning to the student, meaning that you have to embark into a critical pedagogy perspective. What we mean by critical pedagogy perspective? Meaning that we need to give the empowerment to the student. If we're embarking into the outcome-based education, where I will talk a lot about it today, meaning that we are trying to measure what the student be able to do rather than what the lecturers be able to do. So when you're embarking into a learning, you have to give some evidence, some proof, where the student really be able to do. Be able to do what? Depends on your learning outcome, not really on what the lecturers be able to do. So we are thinking a lot about ourselves. We are supposed to think a lot about our students. So we have to know our learners before we really embarking into online learning. For example, their internet connection, where they are, whether they can get some, you know. So we have to buy into the remote learning structure. Either it's online learning or face-to-face learning. I think we need to go from pedagogy to andragogy. And the final one is about heutagogy. Heutagogy is H-U-E-T-A-G-O-G-Y. Heutagogy. Or the other word is self-regulated learning. How that we, when we deliver, we can really let the student, empower the student to learn on their own pace, on their own environment. They be able to deliver or whatever to learn whatever they're supposed to learn. By saying that, we can understand that when we are talking about online learning, there are three things need to be in our mind. That is the content of our lesson, the delivery, and the assessment. So three things as lecturers when we embark into online learning, three things you need to remember is our curriculum or our content. The second is our delivery. And the third part is our assessment. Talking about assessment, when we go online, we cannot really do what we're supposed to do when we have some physical classes. So we are encouraging our lecturers to really embark into continuous assessment. Continuous assessment means alternative assessment. Rather than having summative assessment like tests or having, you know, quiz or something like that, we are giving them some projects, some problem-based learning, some case study or something like that. Then we still can do assessment, but on a different way. Because the philosophy of online learning is to allow students to redo and to realign of their learning. So we cannot really doing what we're supposed to do when we're doing face-to-face, the same as what we're doing online. So a few philosophy need to be understand. That will be some of the thought that we'll be bringing in when I'm going to do the presentation today. Just give me about, I think, 5 or 10 minutes should be enough. Can we have the slide, please, Bapak Fernando? Yes, my topic is about technology competence-based education, a call for action. I try to bring in a new paradigm of how we're going to do or to look at our curriculum. When you look at the photo, not similar to what you're looking at me. That is about 10 years ago. Right? The one you can see on the screen is the actual me. That one is about 10 years ago. Right? I think Dr. Zainal already mentioned about these confirmed cases in COVID-19. We already almost on control about the pandemic in Malaysia. There is no more death cases, and there are only single-digit cases happen every day. There are about almost 2 weeks without any death cases. So Malaysia is quite all right at the moment, right? Next slide, please. Now, when talking about the online education, I think you come across this, the drivers of education 4.0. We're talking about 4.0 now. I think one thing is not there is about the pandemic. Actually, the pandemic really a push factor, immanent factors that everyone have to go into education 4.0, whether you like it or not. You have to embark into education 4.0, where we are talking about digital networks, we're talking about talent investment, you know, share content and resources, and about future skill. And we're talking about drivers of education 4.0, and we're talking about education 4.0, we're talking about, the next slide is about you can learn anywhere, anytime. And you have to give the student ownership to learn. That is the ownership to learn. You can learn anytime, anywhere. And the main thing about education 4.0 is personalized learning. I did mention about heutagogy. Heutagogy actually is about like empower the student to learn at their own pace. That's what we call it as personal learning. You can learn anytime, anywhere. And the other thing is about doing the assessment. As I mentioned earlier, you evaluate them, not examine them. So these are a few features of what education 4.0. So when the pandemics happen, whether you like it or not, we're actually in that kind of education 4.0. We are doing all these things, whether, you know, some of us suddenly are struggling with it, somebody maybe can really follow actually what is education 4.0. Talking about education 4.0 and drivers 4.0, we also need to know what is the future skill of our workers. So the next slide will give you the overall pictures about the future skill of 2020. So when we are delivering our content, we are doing our deliver, we are doing assessment, we're supposed to fit in this kind of future skill, for example, competition world, globally connected world. This is doing by our ALNC, right, smart machine and all this. I think you can find this in the internet. Next, please. Now, looking at education 4.0 and the future skill, I think we need to think a lot of about the future of learning. So the changing point is the way forward is a diverse learning ecosystem in which learning adapts to teach students instead of them trying to adapt to university ecosystem. We are going to the other way around. If you look at a few points, for example, a wide variety of digital networks, platform and content resources will help learners learning, meaning that we have to teach less, but the student learn more. Or what Bapak is saying this now is what Merdeka, Merdeka Belajar, Merdeka Campus, something like that. In a Malay or Indonesian word is kurang ajar, lebih belajar, teach less, learn more. Meaning that we have to empower the student to do the learning and rather than we are doing the learning, right? So there's a few points that you can really look into it. I know to go, a lot of things been said by from Richoy to the other three speakers. Next, please. And then come this COVID-19 pandemic. How is it the COVID-19 pandemic? I would like to suggest a different thinking when we are doing our delivering of knowledge. What I call it as competency-based education. Next. Okay, next then. When we are saying about competency-based education, Bapak, next Bapak. After the pandemic, this is a small survey done in the US looking at how will you rate the level of success or institution associated with moving in-person classes to a remote online setting that spring from following activities. We can see the percentage of it. For example, having technologies, I think most of our university are capable of having the technology. I think we can support the needs of the learners. But during the pandemic, when students are at their hometown, at their homes, some of them have a low bandwidth and they don't have the access to the internet. So the next semester, we allow the student to coming into the university, but the online classes still happen, but using the facilities of the university without the physical classes. And you can see in how they are going to buy in and all that. And you can see the percentage getting lower and lower when looking at the other variables. Okay, next. Now, looking at what's happened for education 4.0, looking at the pandemic, we need to do something, the future of education. So the future education is not try, when we are delivering our knowledge, we supposed not to deliver everything to the student. Because the internet now is the best knowledge gain rather than the lecturers itself. What we know is comparable to Google or some other platform is really maybe just 5 to 10%, right? So we need to really focus on something what you call it knowledge or skill, build around individual, what Education 4.0 is saying, that is individual learning, pedagogy, personalized learning, and learning together and from each other. Although we are doing it online, we still can learn together and from each other, right? Next. And by saying that, you can see that now, I think it's happening now, we have to really shift from what we are doing before the pandemic or maybe 5 or 10 years before to the way forward. For example, we need to move from episodic learning to a continuous learning. Meaning, on their own pace, whether the student can be, the competency they regularly achieve or not. From assigning to addressing with content, from content conveys to content curators, you don't have to give everything to them. From working at one scale to working up to and down to the scale, from degree to reputation metric, Even National Bureau of America are looking for skill rather than degrees. Even there is a movement in the world, no degree needed to find a job, right? From grade to continuous feedback, and from you know, individual learning to collaborative learning. So by having this key shift to watch, we can really look into our curriculum, our learning outcomes, our delivery, and our assessment. The main thing is, are we really measure, are we really deliver what we're supposed to deliver to the student online, right? Next. Sorry for this. This is actually, what we can do is to shift is the two main words is about, there are two leading areas for change. That is the conceptual, meaning we have to build up a new models of learning. For example, ALNC, really the signature program of the SEEDS program is really a contextual learning. So can we do contextual learning online? Maybe we have to come up with a new model of learning. Developmental of social learning theory, where engagement, socialization should be the important things about online learning. Online learning means, doesn't mean that the acting will come from the lecturers. You need to empower the student, you need to engage with the student, where AI element and also automated feedback element should be in our online programs. And the technology is like e-learning and smart learning should be the accelerator, or we call it as the apps of the to guide our learning principle. Next, please. This is creating by looking from Bloom taxonomy. For example, most of us are familiar with this. When I deliver knowledge, we are measuring the student from understanding to creating. So for example, creating, be able to create. Now we have to do the assessment by looking at blogging, filming, forecasting, and directing. Meaning that the higher order thinking skill online is looking at this. Evaluating, when you're measuring whether the student be able to evaluate, we are looking at, you know, testing, grading, and something like that, analyzing by mind mapping, saving, linking, validating, all that. So we have to change our terms of learning outcomes to a more technical words that we can really measure it online. Okay, it's just exciting. Next, please. And this is also another example where we're looking at, this is some, I can't remember the person who introduced it, but we're looking at from level 6, we have to go to what the application model by looking at whether the student be able to think and to do it. From just know to apply the knowledge to in discipline, across discipline, apply to the real world and apply to world unpredictable situation. This will be the C5 to the C6, meaning adaptation will be the highest order of thinking skill. So when we are doing our curriculum, content, when I will deliver, when I will do our assessment, we will try to be at the C6 and also at the A5, right? This is one of the model, okay? What we call it as education competency-based learning. Next, please. So when we're saying about, I think this one we can really skip. I just want to, when we're saying about competency-based education, meaning that a flexible approach that allows the student to pursue personalized learning pathway. For example, I'm from UNIMAP as a student. Can I just accelerate my learning by, you know, joining Asian Learning Network programs, you know, I get more credits, and can I finish my study less than what been provided, for example, 4 years, can I finish in 3 years? If I can really accelerate my learning. Because when we say about competency-based learning, it's also about outcome-based, performance-based, and standard-based education. So regardless of time, place, or pace of learning, maybe I want to take one semester off and I want to be at Parayangan University to learn something else, right? To learn something else. So that also you learn on your own time, place, and pace of learning. I want to get married for 1 year. Can I off for 1 year? It doesn't mean that when you finish your degree in 5 years, you are a slow learner. Actually, it's your competency-based learning. So based on your competency. So this is what I suggest. We are looking back at our curriculum, our content, where we give the empowerment to the student to learn on their own pace and to learn at any time, any place, whether you know, at their own time, place, and phase, in line with what we are saying about education 4.0 and also the drivers for technologies. Next, please. So what is competency-based learning? Is competency-based learning actually focused on ensuring students truly mastering academic content regardless of time, place, pace of learning? I can be one semester at Parayangan, one semester at ITB, one semester at Sambeda, doesn't matter, as long as I can finish all the thing. So as our Asian Learning Network, we can provide that opportunity for our students to really building and develop, you know, doesn't matter where, time and place, at their own pace. Next. Then this is the thing that we can do in making into our classroom. And I want to suggest the other things about competency-based learning, if we need to change our system, the way we manage our student. I'll give you the models how we can really manage the competency-based learning. Next, please. This is okay. Next. This is the thing that you have to consider before you really embarking into competency-based education. Student relationship management, the student information system, the curriculum management, the student success, the assessment, and all that need to be revamped. What is having now in our record and you know, department and all that, in our exam and record department, we need to look at more at e-portfolio, you know, teaching and learning tools. We need to build up a new system using technology, using online, where we can really accelerate our curriculum delivery and assessment. Suggested on the next slide, please. So this thing can be really been seen on different path. Maybe it's too big. We can start as what we suggested next. Just focusing on student information system, the learning management system. Maybe we have our own learning management system at our university, and looking at the processor, the financial aids, or you know, and then we can come up with a transcript that really measures the competency, not really measure the knowledge only. We also measures the skill, the ability, and the attitudes. So maybe we can start to embark this into our education system. So competency-based education system by using technology actually is empower the student to learn at their own pace, anytime, anywhere, in line with education 4.0, rather than really looking at, you know, graduate on times and all that. So we need to do something different, because the technology actually accelerate learning rather than, you know, rather than really make the learning very difficult, I think. So we need to have a customized competency-based learning model where we can really know our learners, and we can really flourish our learners, empowers our learners to really be the citizen of the world. For that note, thank you very much. Back to you, Bapak Fernando.
Okay, thank you very much. Ali, very fruitful and inspiring sharing for us.
Thank you.
We will proceed to our second speaker. Our second speaker is Ibu Retno Agustina Eka Putri, PhD. Ibu Retno is currently Dean Faculty of Economics and Business University of Bengkulu. Dr. Retno finished her BA in Economics from Gajah Mada University and Master of Science and PhD from the University of Tennessee. Dr. Retno's expertise is on development economics, public economics, and microfinance, and she also has several experience as Department Head Economics Development, Coordinator Graduate Program in Economics, Regional Economist for Indonesian Ministry of Finance, SME Consultant for Central Bank of Indonesia, Financial Management Advisor for World Bank Project. Without further ado, Dr. Retno presentation will be on charting the new normal technology use in the rural area. Dr. Retno, the screen is yours.
Thank you very much, Pak Fernando. Good afternoon, everyone. It's really my pleasure to join the ALN, Asian Learning Network webinar series today. I think we all understand that how important is the network. And during this time, this pandemic COVID we became realize that networking is become more and more and more important to connect us together here. I remember several years ago, the meeting will be on San Beda or Vietnam and anywhere else that we can meet and share personally together. But this time, we have to go through this webinar. Okay, well, I think my presentation will be different from the previous presenter. In terms of the previous is discussing about the university, how the network will be important in this aspect, but my presentation will be on the more to the economic and more to the rural area of that. Because we understand that the most of our students depend their scholar, depend on the economic when the pandemic has impact on the income of the family, then they will have difficulty to join the session on the university. And joining the learning to like this, the learning in a non-physical meeting will be much more difficult for them. But okay, I will share a bit, then I will make it short and quick so we can have more time for discussion. Let me share my presentation. Is it already there, Fernando?
Yes, we can see your screen at the moment.
Screen is there? Okay.
Yes, make a full screen.
Oh, okay. Is it done now? Right now?
Yes, okay.
All right, thank you, Pak Fernando. My topic will be charting the next normal, the technology use in rural area, let me see. Okay, and the topic will be in four topics that I will be discussed. Not all, I will skip some of them because it's already discussed by previous presenter. The first one I will discuss about the basic countries macro indicator, population, rural population, population growth, and product domestic brutto of the country in the ASEAN. And second one is the impact of the COVID-19 on the health, the direct impact, and the economy, social, and community or social. And the third one is the questioning, why rural? I will discuss about the world population and trend on rural and urban, and how the movement we see here in mostly in Indonesia that is not rural to urban but urban to rural, and maybe we can discuss that what happened in the other country. And the third one is about the massive program of the government about the Village Fund program. And the next one is the next normal or new normal. We'll discuss about the internet computer access and how to repatriate village and how the village own business as a part of the government program during this next normal situation. Basic macro, I don't think I just make it very quick. We take a look the ASEAN country here, that the area, of course, is Indonesia is the largest, and then Myanmar and then Thailand. But the total population is also Indonesia, followed by Philippines and Vietnam. Most 10 population is in Singapore, 7,833% per kilometer, and then Philippines and Vietnam. But the highest annual population growth is Brunei Darussalam followed by Lao. And in terms of the GDP or gross domestic product at current price here, we see that Singapore is the highest and then Brunei Darussalam and followed by Malaysia. In terms of the purchasing power parity, the higher is also Singapore and then Brunei and Malaysia. Take a look that the highest to the lowest is quite diverse in here. So this is the ASEAN that we will discuss. And if we take a look of the population, the rural population as a percentage of total, the green one is the 2000, year 2000, and the 2018 is the blue one. In the 2000 and 2001, only Brunei Darussalam and Malaysia, that the percentage of rural population is below the world population, the world percentage of rural population. Indonesia in the year 2018 is the same as the world average of 45% in the rural area. But in terms of the growth in the rural population, Brunei Darussalam, Indonesia, Malaysia, Thailand, Vietnam experience the negative growth in the rural population. But Cambodia, Laos, Myanmar, and Philippines have the positive growth in the rural area. So if we discuss about the COVID-19, I'm gonna skip this very brief because I already mentioned it's discussed by the previous presenter. But we recognize there is a direct and indirect impact. Direct is health. Because of the pandemic, your health is in danger. And because your health is in danger, indirect effect is on the economy of the community, of the country, and the social and the community engagement like this one that we cannot see. We can only meet online. And the second one, we can differentiate between the transmission, consumer and producer. We take a look at demand and supply in this case. This is already discussed that the looking at the chart, the second chart especially, that all of the country is still up than in the reported cases of the COVID-19. And the lowest is in the Myanmar and Cambodia. Cambodia and Vietnam and Singapore is already show the flattened trend compared to the other that is still very high. GDP forecast, it's a lot of forecast. It's a lot term in the forecast. And I'm using this forecast from the Asian. Then it will show here that all of the forecast is revised from March, from February to April. All forecast is lowering than the previous forecast in the end of the year, last year. The highest forecast, however, is still in Vietnam. And the lowest is in the Singapore. It's a forecast between -4% to 1% from the March 2020. Why rural? If up on the 2020 this year, mentioned that the investing in rural people is investing in a brighter future for everyone, and I agree with that. Most of the people is still living in the this ASEAN countries that I mentioned before is still living in the rural area. And one also mentioned by Prof. Sumodiningrat, Gunawan Sumodiningrat, my senior there. He mentioned that the role of village in COVID-19 pandemic is as a last resort for unemployment. How it can be? The COVID-19 pandemic may erupt burden on a village development. Why? Because worker from urban area will come back to Philippines, especially the migrant, when they lost their job due to the pandemic. This is happening in Indonesia, and maybe, I don't know, with another country, maybe we can compare with that. But comparison between rural is not easy. In March 5th, 2020, the UN mentioned that to facilitate international comparison, they use the term of degree in urbanization. So if not going to rural, then to urban, something like that. But it's more easy to see the urbanization. So what is cities, towns, semi-dense area, rural? If you compare to one another, it's not an easy one. In Indonesia, the law number 6, 2014 mentioned that Philippines is a regional unit that occupied by number of residents as a community unit, including a legal community unit at the lowest government organization. So this is in Indonesia, but the other country use the Philippines term in terms of the number of people on that. So Philippines development concept, the massive program of the government in Indonesia to supporting the Philippines to develop, to improve the economic by the goal and the Philippines development is the people welfare, quality of life, and the poverty eradication. Now, how to be strong, to be developed, to be self-reliant, and become the democratic Philippines. What is the scope of Philippines development? Basic need, infrastructure, local potency, and utilization of natural and environmental resource. This is what the program looked like in terms of the amount of the fund, government fund allocated in the Philippines. Starting in the 2015, the IDR 20.67 trillion is disbursed from the government and is distributed to the 47,952 villages, which mean on the average of 280.3 million per village on the 2015. On the 2020, is already 72 trillion IDR, which means to distribute to the 17,953 villages mean close to 1 billion. 1 million is 960.6 million per village. This is on the average, so it's a plus minus on each village. And if we take a look of this, this is Indonesia, and we see that the more dark means that more fund distributed on the area. The distributed area here is on the central and east Java, north Sumatra, Aceh, and also Papua. And the other one is less. Why is it? It depends on the village itself. Now, after discussing that, what is it to the country? Take a look. We were online now. We are online now. And if we take a look here, the internet access per household per province in Indonesia is only for a province that has more than 50% household has the internet access. And I'm living in Bengkulu. Bengkulu is somewhere here. Less than that. I mean, like, it's only Kalimantan Timur, Rio, Jogja, and Jakarta, who has more than 50%. In terms of the rural and urban, there is no differences between the year 2015 to the year 2018. It's 28.61% around that throughout the year for percentage household that has a computer. The internet access is per household by area, rural and urban, is a bit different because it's improved in the urban. from 57 to 78, but in the rural, also in the rural, it's all from the 26.84% to 51%. If we have a class and it involves students from not all in urban, then it may be a problem in this. Social media in Indonesia, this is what happened in Indonesia. Most use YouTube, WhatsApp, and Facebook. And it's a lot of users in that. And the other one is that the internet user in Indonesia, the mobile phone, I highlight here, is 124% of total population, meaning that more people have more than one mobile phone. They use smartphone most of the time for chatting, social networking, entertainment, less in the map and shopping. Map maybe because we are not traveling a lot, so it's not that much. So what is then the role of the village that has so much support from the government? And it's through all the Indonesia, 74 million village that has this program. The role of village own business entity, the BUMDes, especially doing that business in the good leasing business, social service, microfinance, joint venture, and something like that. And the community role on the BUMDes is planning and implementation. One of my study is on the correlation between participation on planning and implementation to the development of BUMDes. And it shows that a significant correlation between that. Participation high on planning, involvement in implementation, then the BUMDes will develop more faster than the other. This is it. I would like to end that the rural has significant role in the recovery of the economy, and that institution should revitalize. And I heard from previous presenter that this is blessing in disguise. Product local, we can have more product local here because we don't have much access to the outside the market or producer. Producer and consumer relation, it is an opportunity to have a different meaning of the engagement, the relation between that. The, maybe the online market this time, as simple as using the WhatsApp, we can have that. And the last one is innovation of the product, collaboration among stakeholder, community, business, academy, government, and media. This is a short presentation, and I thanks for your attention. Terima kasih. Stay strong, stay healthy. Thank you.
Thank you, Bu Retno. Thank you. Terima kasih, Bu.
Thank you, Dr. Retno, for giving us new perspective from the perspective of technology use in the rural area. We will have our question and answer session after the our third speakers. So if you have any question, please do not hesitate to type in the chat box. Okay, our third speakers is Dr. Eknarin Ruangrak. Dr. Eknarin is currently Assistant President for Student Development, Prince of Songkla University, Pattani Campus, Thailand. Dr. Eknarin finished his Bachelor of Science as Master of Science from Wallailak University, Thailand, and PhD from the Chinese Academy of Agriculture Science, Beijing, China. Dr. Eknarin's expertise is on urban agriculture. Dr. Eknarin's presentation will be on new normal COVID-19 pandemic stimulated the disruption of agriculture technology. With us already, Dr. Eknarin. Okay, Dr. Eknarin, the screen is yours.
Thank you, Dr. Fernando. Okay, I would like to share my screen. Okay. Uh, Okay, everyone can see my PPT, right?
Yes, we can see it.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. I am Dr. Ingrid Nanggat, and today I am going to talk about the topic of the new normal COVID-19 pandemic, stimulate the disruption of agricultural technology. So in this topic, I am going to talk in three main subtopics, including before COVID-19, during COVID-19, and after COVID-19 pandemic, okay? Before COVID-19, world population have estimated that will increase to reach 9 to 10 billion people within 2030, and population in the city will increase because people love to stay in the city more than the rural area. Maybe because of staying in the city is more convenient for living. And then if you see in the map at the years of 1953, and then the red color that mean the urban area, the people staying, and then in the year of 2000 and in the years of 2030, that is the estimated from the population city, you know. And then if you notice that the city is grow up beside the sea and cost of life more than the in the mainland, of course the agricultures mostly they provide and process in the mainland. That means they have to transport to the coastal areas. And then that is different place between people staying and food producing. And before COVID-19, global agriculture trade had rapidly grown. They had imports and exports across the world, and about world self-sufficiency ratio, I mean production and consumption, like research from the Thomas Gassner and colleague 2014 have mentioned that the country that highlights with the dark blue color, they have high sufficiency ratio and can export the agricultural products to another country. All right. For as shown in this one, 2008, in the year of 2008. But another world map, I just put it for reminding which places, which country, something like that, for all of you easily to recognize it. And then, but some country that have highlighted with the red color mean that they have very low ability of the self-sufficiency ratio, and followed by the country that have highlighted with the yellow and green. Yeah, yellow and green color mean in the medium level of the self-sufficiency ratio. Before COVID-19 pandemic, by the information that I have previously mentioned before, seem world demand for food is higher. So worldwide strategy of the agricultural production focus on big data, large field production to produce in higher yield, higher products and higher quality. And the production of the agricultural product finally have sent to the place in the market waiting for the customer in the market. That's the one. But after COVID-19, distributed from the Wuhan, China, the system of the agricultural production has stopped, and now people have infected around the world is around 11 million people, and see more increase around the world, increase more around the world. So during COVID-19 pandemic, COVID-19 has transformed customer behavior. Customers love to buy through online and send the food product to the door of their home more than they go out and shopping as before COVID-19 pandemic, because people feel that more safer and convenient. So COVID-19 had changed the behavior of the customer already. However, food insecurity rise up after global had locked up. That means cannot export and import agricultural product and disturb to other business around the world. This situation rise up the hunger population to be high, around 135 million people and 265 million people of the starvation after COVID. And right now, they have many countries that facing the food insecurity, like Yemen, Congo, Afghanistan, Venezuela, Ethiopia, South Sudan, and actual in this class. Most of them right now is found and facing in the food insecurity and in the acute of food insecurity right now. So any country that have that they have high food self-sufficiency ratio, then they can survive and pass the critical situation like this easily. Nowadays, agricultural system has been developed for self-sufficient, for example, rooftop farm, community farm, and backyard farm. All self-sufficiency agriculture is so-called that urban agriculture system. The urban agriculture system have many techniques and technology, as previous I have mentioned it, and more like vertical farm, hydroponic farm, aquaponic farm, microgreen farm, and other farm like aquaculture and animal urban farm. So benefits of the urban agriculture have many, like food insecure, food security and diet quality, community economic development, mental health, urban design and well-placed neighborhood, educational and skill building, local foods, biodiversity, and other as shown in this slide. And therefore, increasing of urban agriculture is one of the result of the COVID-19 pandemic that stimulate the disruption of the agricultural technology, and it's become a new normal after COVID-19. And finally, thank you so much for your attention.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Eknarin. Very insightful information for myself as a management lecturer. This is definitely a new perspective. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we are now open for the question and answer. You can raise your hand and we will call your name. I'd like to ask, please make your question or comment short so others can have opportunity to ask or comment. Please state your name, institution, and to whom you are addressing your question. With us, we already have two questions. Okay. Okay, the first question is for Ibu Retno. How do you see the potential role of local wisdom? And the second from Prof. Faruk Zakaria, Prince of Songkla University, also to Ibu Retno. What is the situation of online business during the COVID in Indonesia? Okay, I think Dr. Retno, you might respond to this question.
Thank you very much, Fernando. Thank you, Ibu Sylvia and Prof. Faruk. The first one is, how do you see the potential of our wisdom? Well, during this pandemic, I really feel that the, I think the, I mean, the relationship between the people in the area is getting stronger, social capital increase. People feel that the support for each other is more sincere. I think that we keep thinking that life is very precious, and the sharing with others will enrich our knowledge and the enrich our heart and make us happy. And I see a lot of people doing that, helping the people who need, well, for daily need. Many of the cities, suburban, putting the food and giving the food to each other. So they have helped very much. And I think this is what is the blessing in disguise. We keep more stronger and together. I think maybe Bu Sylvia also feel the same during this pandemic. And maybe all of us feel the same. What is more important than helping each other? And I think I feel blessed to be having this situation. Besides that, we are all hoping that this pandemic is hopefully just go away, and we know that we will go normal with the next situation. This is my, I think, my answer. And the second question, Prof. Faruk Zakaria. Situation on of online business. The previous presenter, Dr. Ekrap Darin Ruangrak, thinking about agriculture in the urban area. And my presentation is agriculture technology in the rural area. The situation now, because of the people will not be able to meet each other very much, supply and demand is, well, have a problem on the equilibrium on that. So online business, especially for the daily need, food and I think vegetable, fruit and et cetera, is growing in the situation. We see that the online market online business is growing during the period of the March to June, on July right now, but the data is on June, is growing, and we expect more that the rural and the urban will have a market on the business. They are using like WhatsApp, mostly WhatsApp, and then maybe on the Instagram. They use that, and the each of the BUMDes, the village owned enterprise, also work together on the market, online market, and this is very good, I think. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. We have one question from Ibu Sepriyanti Eka Putri. I will unmute you so you can ask to Dr. Agnarin directly. Ibu Sepriyanti Eka Putri. Oh, okay. So I will read the question to Dr. Agnarin. What opportunities are this post-COVID-19 to stimulate food system related to agriculture technology?
And what role could major international food companies have addressing in the lack of access to food low and middle countries in COVID pandemic situation? You can read the question in the chat.
Yeah, I already read this one. Okay. Thank you so much for the question. That actually the urban agriculture that is right now before COVID-19 also installed and then become famous because of they are after produce and then they send directly to the customer, and then people when what they buy they have seen how to produce, and then the technology nowadays like technology for growing right rooftop technology, we can grow the plant, we can make the plant on the rooftop of the building, and we can rising or manage the city to have a kind of agricultural farm like that to facing the city people where the people stay if have the can produce the food. That is that means can make sure that if we have any kind of crisis, then people around us can produce the food. For example, in this COVID-19 pandemic, sometime lockdown the province. We not talk about the lockdowns the country. Lockdown the province. For example, Pattani province, they cannot produce. Mostly they import the food from outside the province. And then when lockdown 1 month, the food is quite difficult to find and more expensive, something like that. But if some country that they cannot produce some kind of food by individuals in the backyard or something like that, and quite difficult to find to produce. Even you have money, but the first priority for the life is food, something like that. So nowadays technology is high enough to grow the plant in the building top rooftop or some vacant lots in the city, some public area in the city, something like that. I'm not sure I'm answered the question or not. If not, then please question again. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. We have one question from Dato Zainai. As stated, urban agriculture as an alternative new normal. Would you all elaborate further on the required new skills and knowledge? So what's the skill and knowledge needed?
Actually, people, if talking about the people in the city, of course, they reach to the knowledge easier than rural people. They are stay in the rural area, something like that. And then now they have some company, they provide some material for the urban agriculture, like a set, you just buy the sets and then you can grow, you can feed or raise animal or something like that, you know. It's complete in their technology. You just buy it, and then, of course, like hydroponic culture, fertilizer or anything is not difficult as before. It's already complete. You just buy it and then use it. It's more easier than agriculture. The traditional agriculture is more easier because of technology. I can say like that.
Okay, I think Prof. Zainai's question is also for others to presenter, maybe to Prof. Saleh. Would you elaborate further on required new skill and new knowledge during this post-COVID-19? What's the new knowledge and skills needed? Maybe I begin with Prof. Saleh first.
What I can say is I'm looking from the education perspective because of when we are teaching online, when they deliver online, we are talking about the competency of the deliverers. So I would rather say that when we say new skill and new knowledge, I think we need more than a facilitator, we need more than a teacher. Meaning that as an instructor, we really need an instructional designer. Instructional designer meaning you really well versed of the theoretical foundation of the pedagogy, plus you know how to design your delivery by using technology. So we really need an instructional designer and maybe a media developer and the infrastructures. And plus, I believe all of us need to look back at our content of the curriculums and our program objective, whether we really meet the what we call it as the need of the education 4.0 or the IR 4.0. For example, as a learning designer, we need to really have a proficiency in ourselves in the cyber physical world. So talking about even the agriculture, that's why we and UNIMAP, we have our agriculture faculty where we really focus on technology in developing our agriculture activities. For example, we have two really big projects about our harum manis. Harum manis is actually our mango, where we use a sensor and technology to really, you know, looking at how the degree truths. For example, by using a handphone, by just scanning the leaf, we know whether the plants need more water or needs more fertilizer, and when is it it will be fruitful and something like that. Even when we are using the jet perch is actually the fish. We by by using technology, we know the level of the water, the chemical of the water, how you really can fertilize and all that. So I believe although Asian Learning Network much focusing on the rural or the agriculture activities, but don't left behind technologies and also technical part, because we believe no one supposed to be left behind, although the technology really accelerate. So we need to help our peasant or our student who really embarking into technologies or food technologies. Even when looking at Japanese strategic structures about their strategic planning, they consider for Japanese 5.0, one of the main strategic thrust is looking at food survival. So Japan are looking at food as one of their major strategic thrust in developing their citizen. So then Japan is very way forward in our technology. So make sure that technology goes together as an accelerator for whatever activities we are doing, either we are teachers, we are farmers, we are agriculture, aquaculture, or anything. Thank you for that.
Okay, how about Dr. Retno? You want to comment on this question?
Yes, just a little bit, but I think I agree with the previous presenter, Anshul, Prof. Saleh, and Dr. Ignaran. Well, we understand that it's not easy to move from just regular activity right now toward the new, with the pressure of so many things. One of the things here we discuss about agricultural sector, then we thought that we understand about the health, the importance of the health, how we consume food more, not just buy from somewhere else, but you know how to grow something like that. I mean, this is a new beginning that I think everybody has to think about it. And I thought that the farmer is also have to learn about that, and if you discuss about how the urban people learn how to grow fruit and vegetable on their own. It's not that simple, but it's a process, and we have to go through that. I try right now since April, grow tomatoes, red peppers, spinach. Some of them is growing well, some is not. I learn from others, I learn online, asking who questions. So this is a process. And from the literature, we know that we need people to support who understand the agriculture thing, but it's also because that the community itself would like to learn. So they would like to learn, and there's somebody to help understanding that, and we go through that into the next agriculture system. And I think this will happen right now, and it's a process, and it's in. We have to realize that and learn many things. And I think we learn a lot during this pandemic. I mean, like you learn from webinar, online, something like that. But it's also the student now go to community services, and we monitor them through online. They go to the community around themselves, learning many things on that. I think this is my question. My answer. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Now I'm going to use my privilege as a moderator to ask question, right? Okay, no one will protest me. I will ask question to Prof. Saleh. Prof. Saleh, as we know that this whole distance learning is suddenly happened. We have no prediction before it. So I would like to ask how for us as a lecturer, can we help our students that they might not ready for distance learning? And the fact that now we are apart from them, we have distance from them, they are not allowed to come to the campus. How can we help them? Because one thing, they don't know how to learn distantly, but the second thing, they cannot come to campus. How can we help them? Maybe you have inspiration.
Thank you, Bapak Panando. A very tough question to answer, actually. Before I answer your question, I think every university should have some I think committee or plan of crisis management and preparedness, because I believe this is not the only pandemic that will coming to us. You don't know, maybe the next 2 or 3 years another pandemic will come in, right? So what we are doing now, actually, we are proposing to every faculty, either horizontally or vertically, to go 30% to 80% online. There are no more 100% online for any program or for any courses, meaning every lecturers have to come up with scheme of work where 30% or 80% of their courses or their program should embark into online, either their content, their delivery, or their assessment. So the three things need to be considered in what we are doing now. For example, before we start our online learning, our learning courses, we need to really look into our learners first. So know your learners. So when we do our survey to our students who be locked down in their hometown, there is 4 category of student. One, the student who have a great access of internet, usually in the urban areas. Some maybe have some good access internet, but they don't have a data plan. You know, they just have, some have a very low bandwidth, and some don't even have the internet connection. So for us as a university, as a knowledge provider, we need to give every opportunity to our student to learn. It's unfair for the student to left behind because they doesn't have the internet. Because when we really give them intake, when we take them to the university, we never told them that some of our classes will be teaching online. So it's unfair for them to drop the course or to left the semester because they don't have the internet. So we have to do some other kind of teaching. For example, we need to post our teaching material or teaching content by post, you know, something like, you know, by having a center at a particular district. For example, a few of our students have to come to a certain, what we call it, as a center of online learning, where maybe we can use our colleagues from other university to really cater for our students at the other parts of Malaysia. And on top of that, I think we need to be really familiar what we call it as asynchronous learning. As I've told you earlier, the champion of online learning who can really conduct asynchronous learning, where they really do a flipped classroom and also a guided learning, meaning that you need to provide the things to the student earlier before you really go online. And we have a policy where our delivery online cannot be similar to what we are doing physically. For example, you have 2 hours lecture, you only allowed to be online with the student just about 40%. 40% means just about 20 minutes or 30 minutes out of the whole 2 hours, meaning you need to give the material earlier for the student to access it. And then you just go online just to discuss, just to debate, just to argue. And the last hours of your lectures is for the student to do their assessment, either their project, all that. So I mean, you need to give the empowerment to the student. And then you need to share your material earlier. Then you go online, not to teach, but just to share, to discuss. And you give some additional work for the student to do just to give evidence for whether learning occurs or not. So you cannot go online 2 hours as you give lectures 2 hours. The student just can't bear with it. They are really stressful. They are really stressful. And when I do it online, anything that happens next week depends on what is happening this week. Meaning you cannot really plan your teaching. For example, we have 14 weeks for one semester. You cannot really plan 14 weeks. You have to plan weekly. Because this week you try to deliver online, maybe some doesn't have some access. You can do some formative assessment. You think so learning doesn't occur, meaning you need to plan, you think to repeat your lesson, or you need to do something else next week. So you cannot plan totally 14 weeks if you go online. You need to go week by week. And you have the philosophy of just-in-time teaching. Just-in-time teaching meaning it depends a lot on the situation. For example, during your teaching, suddenly the line can be cut off, there's no electricity or all that. So you need to be just in-line teaching, or we call it in-time teaching. When we say in-time teaching, meaning you need to simplify your course mapping, you need to do a lot of alternative assessment, and you need to do a lot of student engagement as possible as you could. You cannot be the main actor. You just be a facilitator and use technology to accelerate learning. You know, you do through the screen, not on the screen. So that will be really helpful to the student. Even if you ask the student, do they like the online learning? Yes, majority of the student like the way we are doing it, the online learning, because they really see that knowledge can be gained everywhere. And they want to learn anytime, anywhere at their own pace. They don't want to be scheduled to come for lectures, to listen to lecturers. Even the lecturer's material can be found on the Google and all that. So they want something else. They want something aura of the lecturers rather than the knowledge of the lecturers. You know, the lecturers need to be really understand what we mean online learning. The other philosophy is when we do online learning, we need to give the opportunity for students to realign and to redo their learning and their assessment. So that will give the opportunity for the student to learn at their own pace based on their competency. That's what I'm suggesting. Because the student like what is happening now. And you know what? My research is found that the university that doing the conventional learning and teaching is the old university. All the new university are already embarking into the online learning. That's why we have the QS star for online, you know, online star. Meaning that the new university, like, you know, it doesn't mean that when we are building up university, we need to build up all the 4 bricks, you know, all the tall buildings and everything. Even they are only university with just one building, they can still conduct a degree without even facing the student physically. They just do everything online. So that's the thing that I think the good things about the pandemic, whether you like on it, you don't like it, you have to do it online now. It's no more 100% physical. So we are suggesting to our university to go for a blended approach. Blended approach means we had a hybrid curriculum, hybrid delivery, hybrid assessment, and we are embarking more on alternative assessment rather than test and quiz physically. So that will help the student to learn. They will like to be like that. They still learn, and we also still teach. We still get engaged with the student, but in the new way, the physical, the cyber physical way. Thank you.
Oh, thank you very much, Prof. Saleh. Very inspiring. I think if we continue, we can discuss this the whole day, but unfortunately, we don't have, we run out of the time. So we have to end this session. Before we end the session and we end the seminar, I would like to thank you to the three of our speakers today, Prof. Saleh, Dr. Retno, and Dr. Ragnarin, for sharing this session. Now, before we end our session, I'd like to ask you to turn on your webcam, because our publication, our documentation team requested that we have group photos, even though we need to have more than 30 seconds to smile, because we have more than 10 pages of participants now. Okay, please turn on your camera and give your best smile.
Bila boleh jumpa Ibu?
Ya, Pak.
Oh, kenapa saya tak dipanggil Bapak? Dipanggil Datuk saja pada Datuk Zainal.
Oh, okay. Boleh. Boleh.
Okay, everyone, please smile. And our documentation team will do the...
Selamat, Tita. Kenapa everybody very quiet?
Okay, I will allow everyone to unmute themselves. But...
Thank you, everyone.
We can make some noise for the photo session.
Thank you.
Okay, please smile. We need to
organize your seconds.
Doing it up. Okay, I think the
Vanessa, kenapa sedih saja nampak?
Okay, on behalf of Parayangan Catholic University, we would like to thank you for joining us today in international webinar Surviving and Thriving Beyond the COVID-19 Pandemic, Charting the New Normal. We would like to apologize if there any technical issues happened this today. Thank you very much and see you again. And for the information, we have materials. You can fill the form and we will send the material certificate. Thank you very much. Thank you also for Zainai, Prof. Chong, Father August, for joining us the first session. Thank you very much. Good afternoon from London.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Hope to see you soon.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Chong, Professor Saleh. Datuk Zainai.
Terima kasih Ibu. Thank you. Selamat Tita.
Terima kasih. Father Aloy, terima kasih.
See you some other time.
Thank you.
For beloved friend from Philippines, selamat po.
Selamat.
Selamat. Terima kasih Malaysia.
Hi, terima kasih.
Selamat.
Thank you po.
Selamat
po. Thank you po, Father Aloy. Maraming salamat. Mabuhay.
Thank you for watching and listening.
Terima kasih.
kasih Mbak Sylvia. Selamat
terima
ya.
Kasih. Iya, terima kasih Ibu. Sampai ketemu semuanya.
Aloy, thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you to all participants.
Thank you, Rector.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sylvia.
Terima kasih, Bu Tita. Selamat.
Thank you, Fernando.
Thank you. Thank you to
Prof.
all.
Prof. Sale, thank you. Datu. Dr. Lee Choi.
Datu Benay, Datu Sale, Datu Ismi.
Dr. Yuji, we.
Thank you
so much. And everybody.
Much.